It was 1999, and I sort of...
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers!
I want the truth!
...matched a Cadillac through a television pastor's mansion gate.
You can't handle the truth!
Stole his bedroom safe, ran to Mexico.
It was a response from my flesh, my carnal side, not my happy spiritual side.
And wrote a book about every last detail of it.
And if you enter into debate, you give them instant credibility.
Although no one could argue that I wasn't a stupid kid.
I was able to buy a beautiful Cessna Citation jet cash. A few months later, bought another jet worth three times what that one was.
Who knows? Maybe even God himself cracked a smile that day.
A little bit later, bought a third jet. Bought them all three.
My whole world got reduced down to zero. Absolute emptiness.
I would wail out.
I started looking for truth.
I want to know why the universe exists.
Started looking for answers.
Why there is something rather than nothing.
Started looking for God. Then I realized it wasn't the one that was lost. Welcome to God and I Show.
When the Maya speak of doomsday, what they're essentially talking about is the full destruction of the world and the inhabitants on the world.
Guys, you're going to scare everybody here.
Almost every religion and every culture speaks of a doomsday. The difference between what other religions are saying and what the Mayan culture says is that the Mayan calendar, which is an instrument of time and space, actually names the specific date when humanity will end.
Oh, guys, before we get too excited here, let me take a shot at this. Why don't we start with what the calendar is?
A cyclical view of time allowed the Maya to create what many experts consider to be the most sophisticated calendar any civilization has ever produced.
When you're talking about the Mayan calendar, you're literally talking about knowledge of the heavens, knowledge of the movements of the celestial bodies. And this was knowledge that was reserved for the upper elites and for the ruling class. The grand cycle of the Mayas was a 26,000-year cycle that was divided into five equal parts of 5,125 years each. Each of these five cycles was considered its own world age or creation cycle, as is depicted on the familiar circular Mesoamerican sunstone, which is often called the Aztec calendar. So I grilled you through all of that trivia to get you to this. In the Mayan calendar's grand cycle of 26,000 years, we would be in the final phase. Their creation account starts at 3,114 BC. That's when their creation myth happens. Over here is 2012, December 21st, which, according to the Mayan calendar, it's not just the last days on their calendar, it's the final minutes.
We don't really know how the Maya thought about the end of the long count. We don't have any of them to talk to. But we do know that they were very interested in period endings. So interested in them that they actually named the periods for the endings. So logically it would seem that an ending such as the long count would be of great importance and there would be a lot of attention given to it.
It's interesting to note that the Mayan creation date of 3,114 BC does actually correlate really close with Dynasty Zero of the Egyptian Empire. Now, prior to this, which was in about 3,100 BC, give or take, I'll argue the details on that. Before that time, you really just had small pockets of people. There certainly were 6 billion people on the planet. And most of all of the civilizations, or these little pockets of people that had warlords over them, were all around the area of Mesopotamia.
For more than 2,000 years, these ruins remained undiscovered.
For centuries, the only people who saw these remains were occasional nomads who camped near here.
We archaeologists often find more information than we originally hoped for. This is exactly what happened in the Middle East. In the 1850s, when archaeologists first came to Iraq, or as it was called then, Mesopotamia, they were looking for the biblical city, Babylon. Archaeologists knew that early civilizations grew along the banks of major rivers. Here, it was the Tigris and Euphrates.
Here's where I'm going with that, and not to go all biblical on you, but with any of these ancient cultures, whether you're dealing with the Sumerians or the Babylonians, most certainly if you're dealing with the Egyptians, and absolutely if you're dealing with the account in Genesis, you're going to run into a flood story. Well, they say these Mayan cycles have dramatic endings. The serious arguments about the timeline for that flood are going to lie within the vicinity of these two dates.
Was there really a worldwide flood 4,400 years ago? Skeptics claim it's all a myth. However, there's overwhelming evidence that indicates the flood really occurred. More than 270 cultures around our world have a legend of the flood. Geologists find massive erosion features all over the world. Coal seams span the entire globe, some of them hundreds of feet thick. On top of Mount Everest, they even find clams. Now, when a clam dies, it relaxes and opens up. These are found in the closed position, 450 miles from the beach, and 5.5 miles above sea level. So was there really a worldwide flood? The evidence says yes.
Although incredibly strong arguments could be made that would tend to agree with the Mayans' time frame and a catastrophic decline completed by a time period of rebirth and expansion from the area of Mesopotamia, as well as the coincidental fact that you're going to run into no shortage of ancient cultures who are going to tell you that they're descendants from a small pack of people who managed to survive a global flood on a boat. There's nothing magical about the Mayan calendar. It's a calendar. So what does that mean?
The other major cycle for the ancient Maya was the 365-day vague year. It consisted of 18 months of 20 days each, plus one last month of 5 days. The resulting 365-day year nearly matches the tropical solar year, similar to the Gregorian calendar.
The absolute dead center of our civilization is called the Gregorian calendar. Nobody even questions it. The Gregorian calendar was the physical measurement of Earth around the sun, the measurement of physical objects moving through space. The absolute dead center of our civilization is focused on only physical evidence. It's the calendar on which all things are bought and sold.
A calendar is an agreement between a location in space, like where you sit right now to watch this video, and a position in time. It's the intersection of these two things. And time, well, that's something we've been trying to figure out from the very beginning.
What then is time? If no one asks me, I know. If I wish to explain it to one who asks, I know not. Time is what is measured by the ticks of my watch. Time flows. Time is unstoppable. Time is change. Time rules our lives. Time orders what we do. Time is a scientist's most precious commodity. Time is money. We are immersed in time. We cannot get away from time. Time is the most frequent noun in the English language. Time is what keeps everything from happening at once. There's never enough time, including for this talk.
So before we talk about an end date, there's probably a couple of things that you should understand. The ruling class of the Mayans, its leadership and core inner circle of folks, seem to have a very solid grasp on time and its relationship to resources, ultimately control. And although they couldn't put their fingers on it, no one can. They did seem to understand exactly what many of the elites understand today, perhaps the most crucial thing. Number one, consciousness. And number two, spirit. In fact, the human body itself, from bottom to top, is nothing less than a mesmerizing machine, a literal instrument facilitating a mind, and through that mind, consciousness.
Matter, energy, space, time, consciousness, mind, emerged, came out.
How is it that something as unconscious as the matter of the brain can ever give rise to something as immaterial as an experience?
Although none may understand exactly what it is that consciousness that seems to be an enormous part of what makes you unique from every other being on this planet. This human body functioning to hold that consciousness in a location in space and time. One could then guess, just as the Mayans did, that it's through that very consciousness that one connects to spirit, either light or dark. Mayans sort of seem like they pick dark. And spiritual, it's just a fancy word for saying that what you can't see with your eyes is much more than you could imagine with your mind. And what you can't examine with your fingers is much greater than what you can.
If you want to see fear in a quantum physicist's eyes, just mention the words, the measurement problem. The measurement problem is this: an atom only appears in a particular place if you measure it. In other words, an atom is spread out all over the place until a conscious observer decides to look at it. So the act of measurement or observation creates the entire universe.
Only conscious beings can be observers, then we're intimately hooked in to the very existence of reality. Without us, there would just be this expanding superposition of possibilities with nothing definite ever actually happening.
Out of millions and millions of blobs of energy and light, photons and electrons, they make up this imaginary three-dimensional solid world, which doesn't exist at all according to relativity or quantum mechanics.
Anytime we attempt to look at particles beyond a certain level, the very act of observation changes things.
And in addition, the more you look at individual particles, the more you realize that there is no such thing as one electron. An electron or any elementary particle exists only in relationship to other things, like other particles or the universe at large. This means that deeply enough, when you dive down into the nature of matter, everything we know about the everyday world dissolves. There are no objects anymore. There are only relationships. There's no locality anymore. There's no time anymore. The more you look at something in detail, in what we think of as solid matter, the less and less solid it begins to look.
This isn't real.
What is real? How do you define real?
One of the interesting things about ancient cultures is, although they didn't have iPads, they actually accomplished more with less. The pyramids are a perfect example of this.
One of the things that the academics are very good at is denying that a mystery exists when it's quite clear that one exists. For example, the Great Pyramid of Giza, where constructed of 2.5 million blocks of stone, supposedly going up over the course of 30 years, which computes to one or two blocks are going into place every minute. And when you figure that the roof of the King's Chamber is built of 70-ton blocks of granite, this beggars the imagination. So engineers who look at this say, they laugh, because they say, in no way can you explain how these things got levered up ramps and into place in that period of time, or how they got put into place at all.
It's as if they understood the grand scope of the picture without knowing the details. Now, in today's age, as we begin to find the details of things, we soon seem to lose sight of the larger picture.
There is no question that some ancient cultures were more advanced in some ways than we are today. This is consistent with the cycle of the great year.
Much of Egyptology of the last century has been incredibly stubborn and almost deliberately designed to denigrate the achievements of the ancient Egyptian. Part of the blame for this lies, I'm afraid, with Darwin, whose theory of evolution as a linear and inevitable process going from primitive human beings to our own advanced selves, so that it became inadmissible to acknowledge that the ancient Egyptians actually knew more in many ways, certainly, than the Greeks. The Greeks, in fact, acknowledged Egypt as the source of their wisdom, and doubly inadmissible to even suppose that the ancient Egyptians knew something that we don't.
It's an interesting moment when the guy inside the program says, "Hey, wait a second. I think there's something bigger going on here."
You've been living in a dream world, Neo.
Now that we've covered that, let's begin to shift our focus in the direction of the final clicks of this Mayan clock.
Our calendar only has to do with our speck of mud going around this little speck of light we call the sun. In a sea of 100 billion stars, in this one galaxy out of 100 billion galaxies in the universe. So how big is our calendar? These guys were looking at something a lot bigger.
The Mayan civilization was at its absolute peak between 250 AD and 900 AD. This is about the same time that other cultures were entering what's known as the Dark Ages. So while they were degressing, this culture, the Mayans, were developing a calendar with precision that rivals even the Gregorian calendar that we have today. In fact, many in the science realms would consider this Mayan calendar, which is carved on large pieces of stone with little figurines and little details and hieroglyphs on it, to actually be far superior in calculation than even our Gregorian calendar that we use today. That being said, this might lead some to wonder, how did they do this? Well, although there are a lot of proposed answers to that very question, I think it's probably appropriate for this video to share with you exactly what the Mayans claimed happened.
How this deep knowledge and understanding of the workings of time was acquired remains unknown. But the ancient Maya ascribed it to Kukulkan, an all-knowing, godlike figure who, strangely, bore no resemblance to his own dark-skinned people.
The Maya described Kukulkan as a tall Caucasian man with long, flowing, silky white hair and beard and blazing deep blue eyes.
Now, before you go get all warm and fuzzy and puppy dogish about the Mayans because they're telling you that a nice, shiny being popped out of the mix, I'm quoting the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Corinthians, who said, "Even the devil himself appears as an angel of light." Make no mistake about it, those pyramids may be pretty, but they did not design those temples as tourist attractions. If a group of Mayans surrounds you with smiles on their faces, it might not be because they wanted to be friends. In fact, they may have wanted to rip your heart out. Literally.
A Spanish bishop who wrote an account of the Mayan culture described a typical sacrifice of a victim who was usually a child, a slave, or a prisoner of war. If his heart was to be taken out, they brought him to the court with a great show and a large company of people. They seized the poor creature they were sacrificing, very swiftly laid his back on the stone. At this, the executioner approached with a stone knife and very skillfully made a cruel incision. Then he reached in and, seizing the heart like a ravening tiger, tore out the living heart. This he gave to the priest on a plate, who hurried to anoint the faces of the idols with the fresh blood.
Very similar to the Egyptians, the Babylonians, the Sumerians, etc., the Mayans worshipped at their core this whole catalog of dark gods. Underworld gods is generally what they're called. And the underworld gods, in exchange for power and control, you have to do their bidding. Most generally, this is going to include other people's blood. Lots of it. Key amongst these underworld gods in all of these cultures is the serpent, the spiritual serpent. The serpent in ancient cultures was always the sign of wisdom with sort of a negative connotation.
At 3 p.m. on the spring and autumn equinoxes, the play of light and shadow form a serpent's body down the north staircase of the Pyramid of Kukulkan.
We're not sure what the meaning of the serpent's shadow is, only that it's an effect that has a lot of science behind it in order to position the pyramid to create this special effect.
As it slithers down the thousand-year-old steps into the underworld, the shadow of the serpent's body connects to its sculpted head at the base of the pyramid.
You've got to really think serpents are pretty important to get that to happen.
When you see the serpent undulating down the stairway, what you're seeing is the serpent symbolically coming out of the sky, going to the plane of existence on the earth, and then at the end of the day, entering into the earth or into the underworld.
Through all of these civilizations, from the underworld god groups like the Egyptians, Sumerians, Babylonians, leading even into the Romans, and even in symbology that you find today, you're going to find the serpent as the symbol for wisdom. Now, when I think of an animal that could be represented for wisdom, the snake is not the first thing that comes to mind. When we dig just a little bit beneath the surface, what you'll find is that what's being represented by these serpents is a little bit larger in scope than just a common snake. The first account in antiquity that I can find that has a serpent with a spiritual connotation in it would be in the account of Genesis. This would be in the same story where there's a tree of knowledge of good and evil. And of course, we bit the apple. Why? They do make really good computers. I've got one right here. Now, in that account in Genesis, the serpent could be translated in Hebrew as shiftling, with a reptilian, reptile connotation. Now, whatever this reptile, serpentine thing was, in the text, it declares that God himself said that this creature, this reptile thing, was one of the wisest and most cunning creatures. Yet, it wasn't that creature. It wasn't the reptile serpent that was calling the shots in the garden. No. It was the guy behind the scenes. Now, the common names you're going to find for that guy are probably going to be Lucifer, the devil, ruler of abyss, leader of the rebellion, king of the fallen angels, master of the unseen and dark dimensions. That's an interesting one. And if all that didn't twist your tongue, let me boilerplate it down to this. Top dog of demons. Yeah, you could call it underworld gods. In both Hebrew and Greek, the word demon can also mean wise one, with, of course, a real dark and sinister twist. So, what these texts and ancient hieroglyphs appear to be saying Whether it be the Mayans, the Bible, most any of the ancient cultures, including the Egyptian hieroglyphs that you see from the Temple of Hathor on your screen there, is that all of these people believed darkness had a pecking order. And what's the snake's job, you might ask? Well, seems pretty simple. He just wants to bring you a message from the dark gods.
You've got mail.
Everyone I know is on it.
Listen to the snakes. Don't be shocked when you get bit.
It's usually the opening the message that triggers the virus. When that person opens it up, it spreads again.
You know, I think it's probably appropriate right here to quote Jesus Christ, who said, "Be gentle as doves, but be wise as serpents." Now, sometimes we forget the wise as serpents part of that. Please note, he did not say go become friends with the snakes. In fact, he went on to say, "Behold, I give you the power to tread on serpents." So in summary, the spiritual world was very, very important to the Mayans. And the common thread between cultures of antiquity would most certainly be the serpents being part of the structure of underworld gods. Underworld gods being these beings or entities that are literally at odds with their creator. And none of these folks were telling these stories as myths. In the way that they present these, they meant it quite literally, that dimensional things that they couldn't understand were interacting with them. Now, if you find that strange or disturbing, don't get upset with me. I didn't write the text, and I certainly didn't create the hieroglyphs, but I am telling you what they appear to be saying. All of them. So whereas the lighting effect of the serpent's body coming down the temple of Kukulcan happens only once every year, the Mayan long count calendar marks a date once every 26,000 years. Here's what some of the guys watching the skies say happened on that particular date.
If you're thinking that this image doesn't look quite right, you are correct. All of the objects in this diagram are shown as being the same size, when in reality the sun is much larger than any of the planets. But this picture isn't completely correct either, because although the sizes of each object are correct, the distances are not. If we took a real picture of the solar system, the orbits of the inner planets would be too close together to see where the planets are. So the orbits in this diagram have been resized so that the planets' positions are clear. As you can see, there is no planetary alignment on this date.
Bummer, right? Hey man, I thought there was going to be a planetary alignment on that date. Now, it is interesting to note that there are some groups and secret societies, folks like this, who make some very interesting, in fact, compelling arguments about a dark rift and the crossing of a galactic plane. Some people call this the galactic cross. I can't speak to that.
The Mayans themselves describe what they refer to as the dark rift or the galactic plane in ways eerily similar to those of modern scientists and physicists. It is very clear that we are talking about the same event, an event where the Earth passes through the galactic equinox, the dark rift, or the central plane. It all refers to the cyclic and destructive gravitational influence created by the supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way.
Although it may be true that there may be some who have luxury bunkers for themselves, if not for December 21st, 2012, then some other rainy day where things go south, I for one put my faith in a different place, counting each breath as nothing less than a blessing. That applies in times of prosper and calamity alike. Here's what it looks like the Mayans were really counting.
This cycle of the ages was given different names by different cultures. To the Greeks, it was the great year, broken down into four periods: the iron, bronze, silver, and golden ages, each age having its own distinct characteristics. The saints and sages of ancient India called it the Yuga cycle. The Babylonians and Egyptians had still other names for it. And the Greco-Roman Mithraic culture identified it simply by its observed celestial movement, the precession of the equinox. A key observation was that certain constellations follow the same path in the sky as the sun. These 12 constellations make up the zodiac and were considered the most important. Twice each year, on the day of the equinox, when they made their observations, ancient astronomers realized that over time, the constellations were not in the exact place in the sky that they had been the year before. The stars seemed to be moving backwards across the sky, a movement known as the precession of the equinox.
The cycle represents the complete passing through all 12 of the constellations. This is why most ancient cultures' calendar had 24,000 years, or roughly 2,000 years, for each constellation. This is similar to the 12 months on your calendar, 12 disciples of Jesus, 12 tribes of Israel, etc.
At the birth of Christ, the constellation Aries was becoming less dominant in the night sky at the time of the spring equinox, and the constellation Pisces was moving in to take its place. Pisces is the constellation associated with the Christian symbol of the fish. We are still in Pisces today. Very soon, the spring equinox will fall in Aquarius. This dawning of the age of Aquarius is a modern reference to the motion of the great year.
So, for the big question, will the world end on December 21st, 2012? Well, I think Steven Spielberg, Robert Zemeckis, and Michael J. Fox already answered that question.
You've got to come back with me.
Where?
Back to the future.
Are we back?
October 21st, 2015.
Marty, we're going to be able to see our wedding.
Now, if you're hoping for a cosmic alignment, you're in luck. Although the planets look like they're scattered everywhere, there is an alignment with the Earth and the Sun in the center of the Milky Way with the constellation Sagittarius. On that day, enjoy the events in the heavens and the celestial waters. As opposed to looking for alignments in the planets and the grand scope of things, maybe it's more important what we're aligned with. That's the Mayan calendar, in a nutshell. So I had a mother that was deeply, deeply spiritual, and a father that's a mathematician. And one day I'm sitting there, I'm studying anthropology or something. He looks over at me. He says, whether it be in religion or science, anybody that tells you they've got it all figured out is either nowhere near as clever as they think they are, or they don't like where the answers really go. Don't listen to snakes, because they're snakes. Sometimes you gotta hit pause. Take a good look around. Ask yourself, just like in the Garden of Eden, is it me and this body calling the shots? Or am I wearing a mask for something else? Jesus Christ said, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. He went on to say, "Don't marvel when I tell you that ye must be born again." Now in the Greek, born again means born from above, or more precisely, born from the place where this place comes from.
Snakes. Why did it have to be snakes?
You want my opinion? Run right up the backs of the serpents and step on the head of every dark god on the way. Push them out of your path. Let a little light come through. As I mentioned at the beginning of the video, in 1999, I did something that wasn't a whole lot of light coming through. Robbed a TV pastor friend of Benny Hinn's, a guy named Mike Murdoch. He's about a $25 million a year guy. I'm not going to lie to you. I didn't like him very much. I did smash a Cadillac through his gate. Removed all of his electronic doors. Took his safe. Ran to Mexico. It's interesting how all that worked out. You can type me into Google and find out more about it. I'm Trey Smith, not Will Smith's son. I'm the other Trey Smith. You can tell us apart because he's good at football, and I'm not. The title is Thieves, One Dirty TV Pastor and the Man Who Robbed Him. It's a true story, and it's available in paperback and ebook for almost any digital device. George Clooney movies are great. Stieg Larsson is awesome, but I'll be straight with you. I don't think you're going to find anything like this.